So I'm constantly rearranging all the material. And for today, I thought about having two sections. One section is on theater metaphor, concepts for personality, systemic concepts for personality, and communication, just to give you an overview over the variety of concepts we have to develop that fit our systemic approach. If you use classical psychological models, then you, because they have implications that lead you always into a different perspective, we have developed a lot of models on personality and communication that go together very much with our systemic approach. And I just want to show you some and explain to you. Again, all these concepts are in extension explained in the videos you can watch. Frieder will, in the early afternoon, he told me, give you a short demonstration how you access our website so that you once have experienced how you can do that. I know it's really there. And the other section for today would be more the organizational side. This means concepts on leadership, on team, on organizational coaching and organizational development. And my idea is to do half and half to it. The question is now with what to start. With the personality part, I have an exercise for you with the theater metaphor. With the organizational part, I don't have. So my question is, should we start with the part I don't have an exercise for, so that we can do in the afternoon after lunch more of an exercise, or should I start with the more personal and communication-oriented models? You have any idea to that? Who is in front of starting more with the OD-oriented material? And who is more in front of doing more the personal-oriented material? Okay, so OD-oriented material seems to be at the first place. Frieda, then I need the other one. So I had planned to do much more of that, but this is much more programmatic. And the problems we ran into that, you remember from the first day. So, but I want to give you an overview over the work we are doing there, that you know what you can get if you want to have more. So this is the first chart. This is again something around the question, give me a definition. I refer to George Steiner, the anthropologist and philosopher, who is saying they are not sharp, limited concepts that make us understand culture. These are core-oriented concepts that make us understand the culture, and they can overlap a lot. As we had yesterday in the discussion, so we tried to have one term which is opening one world, and another term who is somehow in the near but not clearly limited to the other term. And if you then go into discussing which is what in the classical definition ways, then you get lost. So, and this picture says professional development is nothing really separated from organizational development, is nothing really totally separated from staff performance, leadership for creators, coaching, training, and so on. It's a bunch of concepts which have different core points. And if you understand the core of it, the best way is to give examples that make you understand and not to give you definitions that make you be able to explain. So let me start with some comments on leadership. Last week I've been on a conference in Germany on new authority and new concepts of leadership. I sat on a panel. And as always, for a long time, we had more rigid ideas about leadership being very hierarchical, very much power-oriented. Now they fall from the horse on the other side. So if you fall from the horse on the other side, it's not yet riding. So now they say it's horizontal, we do not need any authority, we do not need any hierarchy. That's nonsense. Hierarchy, certainly we do not need stupid and rigid and authoritarian hierarchy because it makes us feel not good and makes us dumb. But we need hierarchy because hierarchy is one of the oldest principles to create order of evolution. Because if everything has the same chance to be being accounted, then you create a complexity which nobody can handle. And the most important function of hierarchy in an organization is to define priorities and to define frames. And within that frames, you can organize a culture which has a chance to produce useful emerging processes. So certainly it's a combination of both. And we have also a long discussion on leadership, more focused on, are you a leader? Do you have the personality to be a leader? Do you have the skills to be a leader? Do you have the strength to be a leader and all that? So we discussed leadership as attributes of individuals, and with this perspective, we train leadership as personal competence. And this certainly has some meaning to it. Why not? But leadership in an organization has more dimensions. I want to outline these more dimensions. And my slogan here is, leadership is an issue of relationship. So first, what is leading? Leading someone means successfully inviting him or her into performing within a play or helping to create a new one. This is already using the theater metaphor. I thought we would have done it before. So you can say performing within an enterprise or whatever. Just to create something. And whenever you successfully invite somebody to co-create with you in some way, then we call this part of communication and relationship leadership. With a very general definition. So, and we have a lot of books telling us which is the right way to be a leader and what skills do you need and what techniques should you use. I'm saying there is no right leadership. There is only successful leadership. And this has to do with the definition. If it works that someone can invite someone else into co-creating, we do not discuss now co-creating what and how he or she does it. But if it's successful to do so, this is successful leadership. And sometimes the right leadership is not successful leadership. And sometimes successful leadership is not what we really consider to be leadership as a state of the art. So what should leadership do? It enables performance. And this has certainly to do, is beyond command and obedience thinking. So it's based on the idea that we have in Taylorism such a complex system and so complex accomplishments that it's not possible that someone thinks out of everything that has to be done then and commands it. We always have to stimulate the wiseness, the passion of those who are in the roles at the different points. So leadership has to enable that performance, this self-guided performance of people. And this is only possible within a culture, and this is why leadership carries forward culture and or contributes to build something, build new culture, develop a new strategy. So in the theater metaphor we will relate later to this, leadership has the task to reenact the play that is already known and already exercised. This is one kind of leadership, but leadership also means to create a new play. And the differentiation I do, the one is operative leadership and the other is strategic leadership. And certainly it affords different competencies, whether you just make sure that the quality of the performance will be repeated or whether you develop a total new performance. But very often this is mixed up. And very often companies come to me and want us to help to develop strategic leadership, although they have a operative leadership. And I always tell them, no chance to create something new when you not even are able to create relationship systems that make sure that you can keep up quality that is already invented. So it's very often discussed what is the responsibility to leadership. You know that discussion, I guess. Whenever it's around culture or around treating people, HR people should do that. And HR people have a hard time to tell leaders, no, we can support you, but it's your primarily responsibility to do so. So I also believe it's a primarily responsibility from leaders to do so. So it's leadership that takes care of bonding, that people stay involved with the organization and take care of meaning, that people know what they do and why they do it and how it makes sense to them. Because as we said yesterday or many times already, if you don't catch major parts of their soul, you will not catch their passion and their responsibility and their total competence. So it's always a psychological contract involved. And it's leadership that stands for defined values or doesn't. So. And because the smallest unit, if you think in leadership, is relationship, not individual. And competent leadership is a quality of relationship. It's very clear that everybody involved needs competencies. Also the subordinate. It's not a one-way question. And I always tell, at this point, the story, I was a rider when I was young. And when I first time learned to jump over an obstacle. And my teacher said to me, you take your horse, you go directly to the obstacle. The obstacle was as such high. And then you get up a bit so that it's not too heavy for the horse and let the horse do the thing. The problem was, as you may know, jumping is not a natural behavior of horses. And this horse didn't know how to jump, and I didn't know how to ride it while jumping. We both didn't had a lack of the competence we needed to perform together. So we went right along to the obstacle, and I went up, and just before the obstacle, the horse put his legs like this and put his head down, its head down, and the only one who was later behind the obstacle was me, lying in the mud. And next time, I did the same, but I sat like this and said, "You will not get me off." The horse again made like this, and I said, "I got you." And then it jumped, but it jumped much too high because it did that. The horse did not have a judgment how to behave right. So I had an enormous, tremendous, and I flew 5 or 6 meters lying again in the mud. And so the lesson went so on. I've been maybe 17 or 18 times in the mud. It was a rainy day. It was in the open air. So performance was not very good. An experienced person of the riding club observed that, and he liked me, and he had a trained horse, and he said, "Do it with a trained horse," and it went wonderful. I was not competent, but the horse was competent. And I thought, oh, now I know how it is. I went back to the untrained horse. It didn't work. And that's leadership. So both have to be competent and know how to work together. And if you realize that, then it's a good idea to train them together. Or if somebody has to learn leadership and you give them a horse that is trained to that. So give to this person a team who knows how leadership functions, and if the system has competencies, then even a not well-trained leader can be very successful and quickly learn in practice. And then in the next day, he or she might try to form a new team and build up new culture of leadership. So the example makes clear leadership is as good as the conjoined action. And this is the smallest unit. Leadership is a relationship. But in a bigger system, there are always networks of leaderships. And because there is Taylorism, and we all these network actions have to go together to bring up the performance, leadership means that the communication has to go to all relationships in the network which are relevant to work together to bring the performance. So in the end, it's a leadership system. And today, it's only partly a hierarchical system. More and more, it also gets a lateral system. So that's the authority and the power and the competency combination within the leadership is based on very different logics and worldviews and still have to work together. So this means that leadership includes the competence to integrate cultures. And as you may know, I have had a lot of companies where the CEOs saw themselves as great leaders because they had great ideas. But they did not have any idea how to bring these ideas down into the organization until the frontier of the organization where there is a contact to the world. They did not even have a map for it. They said, "I hire the best people in the next level. They should know how to do it." And it was the same with them. They said, "I don't know, but I tell them something and they will find out how to do it." So I invite companies thinking within leadership chains. If leadership has to be tied together with performance in the end. And as you can imagine easily, a chain is as strong as the weakest part of the chain. So why then always giving a lot of training to some of the parts of the chain instead of looking where is the chain the weakest? And how can we make the weakest connections in the chain stronger in order that the leadership chain improves its qualities? So there's a different thinking. And this is only illustrating what I already said. Leadership should integrate realities and actors, and it's certainly horizontally and it's vertically. And today we have new terms like value systems, for example. This is saying our understanding of organizations is beyond borders of single companies. Companies have to work together with administration, with NGOs, with other companies, and the system that is able to create a performance will win. For example, inventing new cars, electric cars. It's not enough that Google or who else produces a wonderful electric car. You need infrastructure. And it doesn't make sense to invest all the money into producing the cars when you don't have an infrastructure afterwards. So systemic thinking means always thinking in the whole system and in the interaction. And there is no predefined clear focus in the beginning. It's from task development to task development, it might be different, and you should be able to map the range of influence you want to bring in now towards the specific situation. And this is a challenge from systemic approach. So, and very practically, I tried to work for years ago with a German development agency from the top. And they had a lot of wonderful political motivated ideas what role the German development agency wants to play in the world. And I should help them to build up the strategic leadership competencies they need for it. And I said, okay, let's take one example. Let's take one representative of the whole chain. This is the CEO, this is the person who has to bring forward this example strategically. This is the boss of the country where it should be transmitted, and he's a boss of a leader of a local unit where it will become practical. And then I had some dialoguing on do I understand the frame of reference of the other? When I say these or that words and I'm oriented to my orientation points, does this person understand that? Or if the person translated to his or her orientation points, is this what I expected? And I cannot judge that, and this is why I cannot lead that when I do not understand as the reality of the next level person, and vice versa. And we did it for 3 or 4 hours, and they have been shocked, and me too. I was naive, because I didn't expect that lack of competence. And so they felt probably a lot ashamed, and at that point I did not have a a good didactic concept to help them over that shock. So they said, this was very interesting. We call you if you need if we need more. They never called me on that point. So, and these are questions you can use for this perspective. So, do you share realities and horizons? Do you share them, or do you at least know what those of the others were? That you can relate to them, either in to act complementary. You don't have to share it. You don't have to make them your own, but you can act complementary. That's a lot. Or you are in conflict with them, but then you know what your leadership situation is. So, do you at least know about those? Can you relate to each other's realities? Do you have communication models in mind? Do you have communication transactional figures? How you can clarify it if you somehow feel you do not understand? Do you have an idea how to organize your question to others? Even if people are in general ready to clarify with each other, they very often are not used to it. So the whole culture, logics of a language to talk about is not there. And it has to be built up. And this is part of building up culture, learning culture. So, and when you look at the whole change, it's the message people down there will give up running through all the chain. And we had the Volkswagen disaster example. Many down the chain tried to give up the message, something is not working here. But there have been blocks between all these systems, and this had to do with the attitudes from the people on the top. And this is why they now want to have a new culture.
In fact, I was also about to take up that Volkswagen thing. Most of us across the globe always consider German companies as something that is associated with engineering excellence, even bordering on the lines of over-engineered products, certainly never under-engineered products that cuts corners or whatever. The recent thing that has happened in Volkswagen, especially cutting corners and circumventing the emission process norms, all that. Is that the act of one person, or is there a dilution of culture across different levels of the company? Has it happened over a period of time? How could they have avoided it?
I now only talk from one perspective. Okay. Certainly, the whole question is very complex, and they also said they have to restructure. There are many perspectives involved. I'm not saying with this simple perspective you can fix things.
No, but as a culture, they had a bigger advantage, because I'm sure lots of people within the organization would have believed in the values that the company is known for. Why did they not do anything to stop what was happening?
I'm not sure whether I stood anything. As far as I understood the case of Volkswagen, many tried to do, but in the end, the culture was that we said it didn't run through the chain, and the people on top didn't think they should listen.
Maybe it became a bit autocratic at that
point. Totally. Because this is the very old style of patriarchal engineer. Driven company, they know how to build cars, people like these cars, this is why they are authorized to decide anything about the around the company, and as long as their perspective, they come through with their perspective, the business will run. And they neglected the necessary developments of culture, and this is why they have this disastrous situation. And we, in the evening, the day before yesterday, the topic was building up culture to build up your business. And so they damage your culture that will damage your business. So, and there are a lot of avoidances of leadership. I only have listed here some, because it's very complex. People who do not have concepts to deal with complexity, they reduce it to few perspectives. And in some companies, for some time, few perspectives are enough to be successful. It's not that something is wrong with that, but then when the time develops, the growth happens, you go into international areas and so on, responsibilities, new questions arise that call for new questions and new styles of discussing, for new answers and new styles for discussing these questions. And then they feel incompetent to handle this complexity, to have models how to reduce it, when, where, the jobs are too big, the workload is too big. So a lot of elements that brings them in understandable stress. And then they reduce their way to govern an organization to some simple ideas like only defining formal goals and just request you reach them, find out how. And don't come back and say it doesn't make sense or you cannot do it with the resources you have. Non-resolvability is no option. And sometimes this helps, that people really are creative, and this is okay. Sometimes people are really creative, but self-exploiting and burnout is a result of resources, of culture and everything. And then they go into the vicious circle of putting more pressure on them. And if the employment marketing is in a way that they always can burn out people and get new ones who give their life forces and qualities into that process, it may be still successful. But it also may come to an end, and especially in Europe, because we do not have so many talented young people, it's coming to end. And because they do not get new people to exploit, they understand they have to take care for the old ones. And this is a chance for humanity. And the other reduction is control or standardization. Make processes totally simple, but many of these processes end up in an administrative monster, and they try it with quality circles and quality standards, and people are more and more occupied with adapting to these administrative control systems instead of doing their creative work they really should do. So there are many kinds of vicious circles. Another avoiding leadership is to be abstinent from it, have an ideology that excellent people, and I'm ready to spend money simply to get the best, and then leadership is not necessary because they know how to lead themselves. This is also working sometimes. But I said, this might, if you mix up a lot of genies, you will get chaos. And if you have the best actors for a play, but a lousy director, it will be a lousy play. And I always tell them, the best actors need the best directors, and not no director. And then they come back with, so systemics told us it's evolving processes and creating from a chaos, and this is a new way to do that. I don't believe that. It's guided evolving. So one of the favorite simplifying system is only control, and the opposite of it, you only control is fall down on one side of the horse, and the other side is only trust, because we don't like this control system now. We only trust it won't work. It's trust and control. Lenin said, trust is good, and mostly it's translated like control is better. But if you translate it correctly, it's saying trust is good, but you also have to control. And this is the same logic of thinking between centralization and decentralization. I had this with Mercedes-Benz. I accompanied Mercedes-Benz for decades, and for some, they have been very centralized for a long time. Then they found out it's too difficult to control everything by centralizing. They said, okay, from now on, you are responsible on yourself, and you do whatever you want, you will be successful. But after a time, they found out they really did what they wanted. And they found out this was not what they wanted. So they switched back to central control, switch into decentralization, because they did not have a leadership model how to combine both. And if you do uncontrolled decentralization, you will if there are missing relationships between the levels of controlling, you will have what I call the aqua planning effect. Is that a word in English? Aqua planning? If you are on the street with your car and there's a lot of water there, and you think you can control your car, but your car doesn't think that. Okay. This is an aqua planning effect. And many leaders do not have a clear system to find out whether their idea how they control the system is really going down to the street. These controlling systems, in the sense of feedback loops and having categories to find out whether it works or not, are most often not there. So they give messages, and they do not know whether these messages lead to any performance anywhere. What I said earlier is the question of competence. We are still much too much focused on individual competence. And individual competence, it's very often what I call role competence. So somebody comes back over and over again into leadership programs because it doesn't work somehow how he tries to apply what he learned in the programs before. And this is why he tries to maximize only a part of the necessary competence. And it would be much better he would use the money and energy to improve other parts of competence. And our formula for competence is, it's role competence. Yes, that you have some experience and some knowledge how to work in leadership relationships. But then it's competence in the field. If you do not understand the play, then the actor cannot give a good performance. And certainly a leader in a small company, let's say in the garden business, he might be a wonderful leader and fill his role in this context, but in another context, he cannot do it, not because he doesn't know basics of the role, but because he doesn't understand the play. And instead of getting him back into role play training, better role play training, he needs to better understand the play. And then as a consultant or educational person, you offer him or her a different design how to learn to understand the system in which he or she plays his or her role. And certainly As soon as you focus on roles, this has to do with the logic of the organization, because not all parts of the role can be defined by an individual. So he must understand that the shaping of roles has to do with the defining processes in the system. And if I feel like I cannot fulfill this role because the logic of the role is not adequate out of some reason, then I should have an idea to whom to talk in order to reshape this role. So today, this always includes the competency to go on a meta level and to know how to reconstruct reality in which I want to act. And the constructionist perspective is an important part of the systemic perspective. And and it's also a question of matching. We did this guided imagery. I don't know how well it worked in this context. Maybe it was not prepared enough. But if the personal style and the style in the organization do not match with each other, then the person might look incompetent. Also, the person knows the role, also the person understands the system, but their style and the system style do not match. And you certainly can try to invest to improve that matching, and sometimes this helps. But if the orientations are very different, then a much better investment is that find out in which context is the matching better. How to change department, how to change company, and then your competence will go up only because the matching is better. And if the matching is lousy, because of many reasons, more and more training, and especially individual training, will not help. As soon as you do relationship training and leadership chain training, then very early you understand how much this is a question, how roles fit together, how styles fit together. So all the contextual competencies that are involved show up if you do not reduce to personal training. So it's role competence times competence as a professional field times matching. So if somebody comes to you and wants to think about his competence, his or her competence, they most think in terms of role competence. But it might be the matching, and it might be understanding the play. And this asks for different services from your side. Otherwise, they invest more and more in some parts of the chain, and other parts are still so weak that the whole chain will not hold the thing. And this is one of our schemata, how persons and organizations match. And from the side of the persons, that's the right side, you have certainly, if you want to do something actively, to improve that matching, then you have to be aware of yourself. So what are my core expertise, my competencies? What is my soul calling for? What is my identity with which I try to contribute to this organization? And how does this fit the function I could achieve in this organization? And because we have now a function or organizational role, this is certainly tied, on the other hand, to the question of organizational development. Is the organization clear about their core businesses and which are the most important roles? Are these roles constructed properly? And the system of playing this interplay of these roles, is this constructed properly? So matching, matching is not only a question of work on the person, it's also a question on work on the company. If the company improves in defining good roles, then the chances for matching are much better. If you have only one money and they come to you that you train people that they learn to match better, you might say to them, you better invest that money in clarifying what your core business are, how the role should be shaped. And if this makes more sense, then people are clever enough very quickly to learn what they have to learn. And you don't have to offer them extra training for that. So those of us who are in the business of education and consulting should have maps for that and not just accept every possible contract. If they feel responsible to the overall responsibility of the client, of the client company, then they should say, okay, I could do that. But as far as I did understand, this is not the best way you could invest. You could have much better results if you do on the organizational side something, or in a specific combination of both, and I'm able to do that. Or I only can cover one part, but I have colleagues who can cover the other parts. And I can work hand in hand with these colleagues. So this calls for developing our identity as service people, and it calls for more complex networks of offerers of services. And here the associations come in. It doesn't make sense to have an association only for one part. This is why we try to create new associations that want to meet these complex responsibilities and not playing their role in the overall play of tearing things apart and trying to solve cooperation questions by optimizing some perspectives. So you see, not only people, not only organizations, but also the professional associations and how they support professional identity and how they what kind of concepts and training processes do they support plays a role in the big game. Is this understandable? Ah, okay. Now I go to the question of team, but if we want to dialogue on what I said up to now, this would be a good point to do so. Micro?
First of all, personally, I must thank you for the fantastic definition that you have brought in on the leadership. It's the first time I am seeing a revolutionary and a radical approach to leadership definition as compared to a standard format of leadership definition.
Thank you.
What you have said is that in terms of leadership is perfectly true, that there is no right leadership. However, there is only successful leadership. What happens is, while even for a moment, if you assume that there is right leadership, the right leadership does not ensure always a successful leadership. Whereas a success leadership will ensure that there is right leadership.
Right.
Because what happens always is that a successful leadership is demonstrated by everyone and it is given a title as a right leadership. And this also is related to time and also sensitivity and culture of the people at that point in time. Let me just take a quick two examples. One is from the corporate world, Jack Welch. Jack Welch of GE is considered as the best leader of the times. So he has revolutionized and turned around the organization to successful leadership, and therefore the corporate world has started terming it as right leadership.
Coming back to political side, Mahatma Gandhi is considered as the best leader of our times. He has transformed the entire nation, and therefore his leadership style was considered as the right leadership. But my question is, these two people were great leaders of the time. Whether their leadership style today may be relevant or not is a question that we have to ask. Because Jack Welch's leadership, when it is copied in today's time, it's not yielding results. Because the times have changed, people's expectations have changed. The fundamental problem is, as you rightly said, is there should be vertical integration and horizontal integration. Most of the corporates and in practical life, we have vertical integration. But horizontal is completely missing. So in terms of the understanding each one's realities and understanding the partner's role is completely missing. In that sense, if you look at even the successful leadership is more relevant than the right leadership is my point, which has been made out very clearly by you, and I thank you for this concept.
Thank you. Yeah, that's absolutely true. And I'm so fed up with people who have developed a successful leadership in a part of our society. And since we all have the tendency, if we advise other people, to say, do it like as I do it. That's human. But if you think about, it might not fit for the other person. And this is why, as you said clearly, leadership in one time and one part of the society might not be a good idea for other times and other parts of the society. But they write books on the best leadership, this is how to be successful. And today I have also the problem on organizational development that most of the examples of modern and successful leadership coming out from trading and IT. And many come from startups. But what works for them doesn't work for traditional organizations. But they are in the front, in the papers now, in public. They make the fashion and make the others feel dumb and not intelligent enough to understand the new times. But that's nonsense. It's again polarization. And I'm very much in fond of understanding how traditional organizations can step by step improve and not running after the visions of startup IT company ideas about being an entrepreneur. And the same is true within a company. You have different leadership styles and different requirements. What could successful leadership be, even in different parts, different departments, different branches of the same company? And meta leadership competence is to have an idea how to combine the interfaces between these different styles, even within the company. If you only want to have one style and include everybody into the styles, you will have an area where it makes sense. You will have an area where you have doubts, and there will be an area where it's just nonsense. And this is true for every concept. Another comment or question?
I have 3 points. Number one, I love that matching competency part. Thank you very much. Number two, we're talking about standardization.
Tailorization, yes.
Standardization. Now, people from corporate and, from organizations and institutions, are we not following a basic set of standard rules in our companies? Do we? I believe that we need certain standard rules which can evolve over a period of time. So, am I in conflict with your concept here?
I'm not sure whether I understood all, but the question of standardization is a difficult and complex one. It's as difficult as systemic. Yes, we need standardization.
Certain set of rules which have to be built upon, but it should be subject to changes, which is supposed to evolve, version 1, version 2.
Yeah, I cannot talk to specific standardizations, but in general, yes, we need standardization, because tailorization and putting things together by standardizations is a success story of our civilization. Otherwise, we would not have the comfort we have today. But as always, is the question, which standards are economical wise? So is it the one standard over a huge field, or do we need more and different standards?
And it has to evolve, yes.
Yeah,
it has to go for changes as and when there's a need.
Yeah, and then when you go on the meta perspective, you cannot answer this on the content level. This is a variety of standards we should have today. You can answer it of helping people who have the local wisdom to be competent, to know for what they should invent standards and what should be open to creative dealing with. And this is for what they need the competence we try to teach.
May I invite you to give me insight into shared leadership? So I've read in books and I've heard people saying that, you know, you should share your leadership. What does it actually mean? Sharing responsibilities or the...
I don't know what other people mean when they use such a term.
No, because, you know...
What did you understand what they mean? What?
I 100% I knew that it's not sharing responsibilities. But I really want to know if others also could make me understand that.
Yeah, I don't know. I only have a fantasy why people invent such a name. This means they are overburdened, and now they have the idea when not everything is up to me, I feel better. And maybe they have only an idea. Sharing means giving load to others. But if that's a good idea, but to make a culture out of it opens a lot range of new questions. And I don't know which questions are there when these people, do these people have when they talk about shared leadership. And probably they will, each of them will talk about a different perspective on a good idea. But they might not be integrated, and they might not fit your situation. So the integration work has to be done. And it's not enough just to produce a new fashion of thinking.
Okay, I understand that whatever we've been discussing, sharing for the past 3 days, it's all about the culture, learning culture. Shared realities, responsibilities, and
right.
So all those things.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you. I feel good when I have the idea. Now things come together.
When you are explaining about the success leadership.
Successful yeah.
And I got a kind of influence on earlier terms where I learned about the situational leadership. So is it something the situational leadership and success leadership is similar, or in what way it is different?
I did not invent the term situational leadership, but it might convey the same idea. You can use a schema that works all the time. You have to find out. And what is new to most people, most leaders, you can to find out by asking your partner, who should be leaded by you, what makes you to be oriented on me? And we call this a process of authorization. I try to gain power on helping you, me, create a reality. But power has a twin, and the twin is authorization. Because I only have power if you are ready to orient yourself at me. So if we discuss that, and sometimes this is also true in consulting relationships. I very often, I could not demonstrate this now here, but I demonstrate in my training groups that if you want to understand what works with your client, ask him. He deliberately usually tells you what will not work and what will work as far as the experience is up to now. There may still be new areas, but if you build up an equal eye level respecting relationship, then they will tell you all they know about that. And you can do the same thing within leadership relationships, vice versa. And so you find out that your style, you think you want to gain authority, does not match the style the other person is ready to give authority to me. And then we have a new topic to dialogue on.
But this creates also a kind of customization between a team, the organization composites of various teams. So
yeah,
this will create a kind of, there won't be now a kind of uniqueness in the leadership.
Yes.
It will also create a kind of customization between leaders. So for example, marketing will have a different style of leadership.
Right.
And HR will have a different one.
Yeah.
So that will work in terms of, as you said, about connecting the chains, leadership chains. Will
right.
It be possible having a different style of leadership and connecting them?
Yeah.
Would it be a challenge, right?
Yeah, a huge challenge. This way of thinking gives us a chance to catch up in the complexity of our self-organization to the complexity of the challenges. And we still are totally under complex. And this is why we run into dilemma and we are drawn into in complexity. And for a long time you can replace successful improvement of example of complexity by exploitation. Now we are back in the symbiosis stuff. Somehow to organize system to have somebody else pay the price for not improving your own complexity. And we do this also on a global system. We still exploit Africa. Also we say, oh, we try to help them as good as we can. No, we exploit them. We misuse them. We put our garbage there. We put our chicken wings there. We destroy their own chicken markets by this. We get the basic material very cheap out there. And this is a thousandfold. The exploitation is thousandfold compared with the real aid we give. And so I didn't know that when I was young, how much our economy today is still based on misuse and exploitation.
Sir, in the beginning you told that any institution cannot set some goal and we can't ask the employee to be goal-driven. What's the negative part of it? When we just display the goals, this is my goal, this is my, as an institution I have such a set of goals.
Yes.
And we ask the employees to just drive behind those goals. What is the negative part when those employees move towards the goals?
I'm not sure, I don't understand the question. Can somebody help me?
What are the consequences when we ask each and every employee to move behind the goal? The management has set a predefined goals for their own institution.
Okay.
And we force the employees to drive behind the goal. What are the consequences in general we face?
In
there is a not alignment to that individual as well as the
This is again a possible polarization. Certainly we need entrepreneurs who have ideas for a company and invite others who don't have such ideas and would at least not have such successful and life standard improving ideas. And this is why when they understand, okay, everybody is motivated different. The one that says, okay, I have a comfortable workplace, I have money, or this company is doing something I feel that is matching my values, then it's wonderful. And leadership is not obsolete, because not many have such extraordinary talents to create such new systems. But on the other hand, economy is for quality of life. I don't know for what in the end economy should be. So we have to think for, I always say we have three, I did say it here already, I think, we have three main goals. One is doing the daily business, one is caring for the future, and one is for caring for the life quality of people involved. And certainly we have to dialogue with them on that. But I do not believe that people are not wise enough to understand that there is an idea or a leader or a company goal they would not have invented, but they are happy to be a part of. When many, many are unhappy, then something is not in order with that goal. Not with the values, not with the products, not with the consequences of pollution of the world or whatever. And I'm not saying the one or the other perspective should be predominant. I'm saying it's important to dialogue on that. And I don't have a solution.
Thank you, Bob.
Mm-hmm. And this is why we so often talk about dialogue culture. It's not a little humanistic tune. It's a question of survival.
Will it also create? This will create, if you go on dialoguing with that your teammates and the leaders, and also changing your life leadership styles to that, will it create a fluidity in the organization or the setup? Because that situation oriented, it will all change. No? Instead of sticking up one leadership and doing it, which is working out, probably, as you said about, might be autocratic sometimes. So this is the team, the goals, and you please perform to that. And these are all the roles you need to perform. And when I started encouraging or inviting dialogues with the subordinates to do that, so the culture-oriented, I need to shift my leadership to participative and sometimes more social and all those things. So getting this would be difficult, no? So it would be create more fluidity and getting to the goals, it may, I am fearing about whether it will reach to the success of getting the goals.
Yeah, I know that the challenges are huge and we all have to learn the attitude that within the universum of non-solved questions, we combine together some questions we can relate to, but this should not be a stupid simplifying. It should be from each world in which he or she is acting, from a systemic standpoint, a meaningful combination, and a combination you really can handle. It doesn't help if you only develop huge expectations, even on yourself, and you are not able to handle them. And because a single person certainly is overwhelmed with all these challenges, we need communities. So we have to shift our attention from individuals, the hero principle, to communities, the culture principle. Gießen, how much time do we have until the coffee break?
We have another 15 minutes. 15 minutes.
10 minutes?
15.
Okay. So, I think it's a lot of, prepared now for our, also for our different understanding of teams. And as I said early, for me, a team, and somehow it's a revolutionary definition as well, it's a community of responsibility. It's not those who sit on the same floor or drive the same kind of car or have the same income class. The problem with that is you cannot fix defined teams, because you have first asked what are the questions that are to be answered right now, and who has responsibility for these answers, to find answers, and and from this perspective, who is then part of the team now? Yeah? And this might, and if you state a problem in a department, is a cooperation problem, and if you think that's a problem because of the IT system is not supporting cooperation enough, then you have to think what questions are there, who is responsible, and then they are the team to deal with that question. If you restate the question and say, no, it's not IT, it is human relationship. It's how people are paid, how they are motivated, how the understanding of leadership role is in this department. Then these are other questions, and they lead to other responsibilities, and other people have to be invited to be the team at this point in time. So it's a very fluent understanding of team, always according to the part of the responsibility world we are trying now to deal with. But usually what happens in team development is that you have a rough idea about the topic, and then you gather people who should be somehow involved, having the idea, the more are involved, the more they will learn something, and then later know what to do. This is just wrong. Instead of at least first clarify what will be the team developmental focus this time, and then to ask who do you think should then be as a team at this point in time. And this is also vertical, because for me, part of the responsibility relationship is a leadership relationship. And certainly people should be in their role. It's not just everybody who should be respected somehow should be part of that team, because then there's a lot of confusion between private needs to be respected, between importance of their contribution to the responsibility at that time. And so you have a culture that everybody talks anything, but it's not focused work on improving on answering the questions. And sometimes it's even propaganda, say, we respect everybody. And if we have an IT problem, why not having the waiter also be respected in how he looks at it? And then you get an overcomplexity of irrelevant contributions. This lead maybe, if you have a group dynamic process, in the end somehow to feeling close to each other. But on Monday, the old system will just come back. And for this, we have developed a control triangle. You know that already, the logic of this triangle we have already talked about is now transformed on teams. So when you, for example, go for a contract on team development, you have somehow to find out what is the task and the responsibility of the team focus right now, as I said in this example now. What is, what will be the focus of the coaching or team development or however you call it? And only then you know who should be part of this team at that time and in which role. So your boss should be, if it's a question of leadership culture, your boss should be part of the team in the role as leader, not in the role as chief engineer. And he should have awareness about his roles and should know that he should behave different if he is in the one role or the other role, and he is communicating different and inviting others in a different way into complementary roles. Otherwise, the roles change a lot without awareness, and this is why you cannot focus enough. So the individual competence of role awareness, and this is my role model, I will briefly mention this afternoon. If people are not used to thinking in roles, they always think in skills and human being. Then this is not very useful to clarify role understanding and role-bound communication. And if you don't have this, it's difficult to organize a task and organizational roles-oriented team discussion. So, and when you know, when you have an idea what the responsibilities you want to talk about, then you know who should be involved. And this may even be somebody from a neighbor's team. This has nothing to do with official attributions to teams. And then you can think about your approach, what you do with them. And there are many ways how you can deal with it. And when you, and the triangle helps you to reorganize yourself when something is not fitting. All the three angles should fit together. And you find out that you thought it's a problem of leadership culture, but they think it's also a problem of IT, and they bring in IT people, and they bring HR people, and then it might be that you have a bunch of people here that you would not have chosen. Then you have two options. You say, okay, let's, if we stick to the focus, not everybody should be here, and some other people should be invited. We have to rearrange the team. Or if these are the people who sit together now, let's think about how we can define the problem that it's in the range of responsibility of the people here. So you rearrange the focus of your team development. And the same is your approaches should fit to whatever conclusion to come. And if you have only one approach, then you have to think about what can I do with this approach? With which kinds of responsibilities can I address, and with which kinds of people, in which roles can I work them? And if my approach is not respecting questions of responsibility and task and not respecting questions of roles, it's only psychological and respecting human beings and how they feel, then I should not do anything in organizations. So this is a team coaching triangle. It's not only for coaching, it's also for leadership, for every dealing with competent life of teams.
Can you explain the self-conception? Coaching approach?
Yeah, self-conception, as what kind of professional do you understand yourself when you work with them? So when I say, I'm a psychotherapist, and I work now with a team, then certainly I'm focused according to the tradition of my professional self-conception, with motivation, with history, with feelings, and all these things. This is why I say in an organization, CEDIS position itself as really working with organizations, they should invite and change self-conceptions of the professionals within. And they should do something that helps them to change. And this is what the book of the guided journey of the caterpillar is about. To show one example of such a transformation of self-conception and skills and whatever has to be tied together.
So based on the team,
as well as the task identified for coaching, we need to find out what would be the good coach would be for that particular task.
Yes,
coaching.
Yes, and certainly.
Might be that maybe from outside or otherwise from
right.
The internal or otherwise from the
right.
Department.
Right, this is an important point. We train a lot of internal people who hire services from outside, and they should have a map on what should be the self-conception of the people we hire, that they fit in this triangle to what our understanding, what the quests, the responsibilities are they have to deal with, and what the team will be. So they get more and more competent in not hiring people who do not fit. And this gives problems to those who do not understand that in the market, because the customers get more competent and they require more context competence from the professionals. And this also goes, and this is why we invite our trainees, those who want to be entrepreneurs and those who are freelancers, that they develop a program what is clearly stating their self-conceptions, so that the marketing mechanisms function in a way that the other person understands this is someone who is able to adapt if it's a problem of economical, strategical, technical reorganization of the team. And this person is also a psychologist, but he or she is also ready to adapt to different procedures, bring in different concepts when he finds out that the focus of the team development at this point in time is different, or at least this person is responsible enough to say, I can, with my self-understanding, I'm an asset, I cannot do the work. Also, I certainly could do some personal consulting with everybody. You can do that anyway, anytime. But I have colleagues which I can bring in that is not complicated, too complicated for you as my customer. You believe that if I'm not the right person, I will find who will be the right system to help me. And so we have new self-understandings of companies of offerers, and they might stay small companies, but they develop networks of companies that together may serve as a bigger picture. So I will not expand on this. This is just saying, but you grasped it already. It has a lot to do with being able to integrate many aspects, many perspectives, and not come to under complex fixed ideas what to do and fixed understandings who to be. I don't have to repeat that. So then we will go a bit to organization development, but after the coffee break. You have questions or comments to this part, team? Is it clear? Is it understandable? You experience it as a progress compared with what we had now, up to now? Integrating certainly all traditional things. I do not want to make the same mistake saying, this is old stuff now, everything is new. As Jarvis Busher, about whom I will talk on the Dialogic OD, he says, it's not to invent everything new, it's to shape new mindsets from which you can integrate all knowledge available so far, but the knowledge is not setting the logic of what you do. Your new mindset helps you to organize your own mindsets, and you integrate the knowledge, but the logic of the knowledge doesn't dominate you. And this gives you back the dignity of a creator, and not as a servant to a fashion or a tool or a concept. And my belief, my personal belief, this is the spiritual part of it. I'm not part of a known religion, but if something is divine in us, is it being part of a creation? So if I'm willing and more capable to be part of the creation of evolution, and this means more and more civilization, then I'm close to the divine potentiality in me. And again, this is not only a question of an individual, it's a more and more a question of culture and community, because no one alone can be that. This sounds good. Now we go to have a coffee break.